Friends, I am Dr. Deepak Koche, working as Professor, Department of Botany, Sri Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce and Science, Akola, Maharashtra. Today we are going to discuss about some fundamental aspects of biotechnology and application of biotechnology in different sectors. Specifically, in today's lecture we will deal with the applications of biotechnology in agricultural sector. As we all know that this biotechnology is one of the most important fast growing field of science. Considering the fundamental aspects of this biotechnology is a technology that utilizes biological systems, living organisms or parts of these to develop or create different products. Biotechnology is a broad area of biology involving the use of living systems and microorganisms to develop or make products. The third most important definition of biotechnology is that it is the integration of natural science and organisms, cells, parts thereof, and molecular analog for products and services. This definition has been given by European Federation of Biotechnology. If you see the basics of biotechnology, the term biotechnology is coined by Hungarian engineer Karl Ericki in 1919, meaning the production of product from raw material with the help of living organisms. As I had already told you that this biotechnology has its application in various sectors. Depending on that specific sector, it has been called as red biotechnology, white biotechnology, green biotechnology, blue biotechnology, etc., etc. So this red biotechnology is related to the medicine and human health. White biotechnology is related to the industrial processing and microorganisms. Green biotechnology is of course related to the agricultural sector. Blue biotechnology related to the marine sector. Yellow biotechnology related to the food and nutrition. Grey biotechnology related to the environmental issues, golden biotechnology related to the bioinformatics and computer science, then brown biotechnology related to the science and scientific advancement in desert and dry regions, violet biotechnology related to the law and ethical issues, black or dark biotechnology related to the bioterrorism and biological warfare. Friends, we are studying this biotechnology since our HSC. We used to study this biotechnology under different heads. So we will see some common heads under biotechnology. So we used to study biotechnology under the heads of traditional genetics, molecular biology, cell cultures, and bioinformatics. So under traditional genetics, we used to study hybridization techniques and selection methods. Then mutational breeding we used to study. Then under molecular biology, we used to study under different heads like recombinant DNA technology, that is recombinant protein, GMOs, gene therapies, new antibiotics and other small molecules. Under the heading of sequencing technology, we used to study forensic detections, gene banks, human genome and evolutionary studies. Then under the heads of DNA synthesis, we used to study detection of probes, artificial gene synthesis and gene mapping, study of gene expression and gene regulation is there, including the antisense technology and RNA interference technology is also studied under this subheading. And the another most important topic is the cell culture. Under cell culture, we used to study the cloning of organisms, then stem cell technology, then monoclonal antibody technology, under which we used to study anti-cancer drug diagnosis and nanotechnology. Since last 10-15 years, the most important sub-branch of biotechnology which is evolved is the bioinformatics, basically. Under this heading, we used to study genomics, proteomics, microarrays, and computational biology. Friends, since the inception of this particular new field of biotechnology, we had seen a shift from a classical to the modern biotechnology. Initially, we used to study the natural regeneration, cultivation methods and practices, then tissue culture and natural breeding processes under biotechnology. But later, we had started to study cell fusion, transfections, transformations, then conjugations, agroinfections, GMOs, and in vitro manipulation of DNAs and RNAs under the heading of modern biotechnology. If we see the development of the genetically modified organisms, so starting with the domestication of the plants, as far as the history goes, the human beings have started crop domestication around 10,000 years ago. Around 3 to 4 centuries ago, we had started the crossbreeding of the plants. In 1940 to 1950, the breeders and researchers seeks the additional means to introduce the genetic variation into the gene pool of the plants. In 1980s, researchers have developed the more precise and controllable methods of genetic manipulation. And in 1990s, we obtained the first genetically modified organism, which is marketable. The first genetically modified organism is the tomato, flower sour tomato, and it comes in market in 1994. Coming back to the applications of biotechnology, I had categorized the application of biotechnology in 4 different sectors: this application of biotechnology in agriculture, applications of biotechnology in medicine, applications in industrial sector, and applications in environmental sectors. Today we are going to see the applications in agriculture basically. So when we study the applications of biotechnology in agriculture, it is more related with the food security aspect, and it is one of the most important aspect as far as the global health is concerned. Today the global population is about 7 billion. About 925 million people around the globe are undernourished, and the expected rise in population is about 9 billion by 2050. And to feed this much population decently, we will need to increase our production at least by 60 to 70%. Now think how we can achieve this. The most reliable answer to me is using biotechnological application. We can achieve this increase in production so that we can feed the increased population decently. The state of having a reliable access to a sufficient quantity of affordable and nutritious food to everyone is denoted as the food security. Now, at this stage, India is a low food secure country, and if we want to achieve the status of high food secure country, we have to opt the applications of biotechnology to increase the food production to feed the increasing population decently. I had categorized the agricultural application of biotechnology into 7 different criteria. The first one, or first application, we can say the development of crops with increased nutrition. The second one is development of insect and pest resistant crop. The third one is the production of the edible vaccine. Fourth one is the production of the antibiotics and growth hormones. Then production of the biofuel using plants, production of the biotic strain confrontation, and development of GM flowers and other aesthetic plants. We will start with the first application of development of crops with the increased nutrition. To start with, friends, all GM crops developed biotechnologically were developed keeping in mind the concept of food security. Here, foreign desired genes were introduced in the crops for genetic modification, or plants' own gene were modified for their expression. For example, golden rice. This golden rice is a variety of rice that is Oryza sativa. It is genetically modified and biofortified crop. It have increased nutritional value in crop grains. It is genetically modified in order to produce beta carotene, which is not normally produced in rice. Beta carotene is converted into vitamin A when metabolized by the human body. And we need this vitamin A for our healthier skin, to increase our immune system, and for our proper vision. This golden rice is invented or produced by two scientists, that is Porticus and Peter Bayer. The Porticus is from Austria and Peter Bayer is from Germany. So the golden rice is a variety of rice, that is Oryza sativa. It is genetically modified biofortified crop. It have increased nutritional value in crop grains. It is genetically modified in order to produce beta carotene, which is not normally produced in rice. Beta carotene is converted into vitamin A when metabolized by the human body. We need vitamin A for our healthier skin, our good immune system, and proper vision. Here I had posted one photograph of the inventor of this golden rice, that is Porticus and Bayer, and at the upper right end I had kept the photograph of the golden rice. Actually, the concept of developing the golden rice has emerged as the probable solution for vitamin A deficiency in children. Now we will see how this golden rice has been synthesized. As I had already told you that this synthesis of carotene or beta carotene is not the character of the rice. It has been manipulated in the pathways of rice. The genes which are responsible for synthesis of beta carotene was taken from daffodils and a bacteria known as Erwinia, and then it those genes were integrated in the vectors, and those vectors were be transferred to the transport those genes to the genome of rice, and then a pathway has been created where this IPP is initially converted into the GPP, then this GPP is converted into the phytoene with the help of phytoene synthesis, and this phytoene synthesis gene was taken from the daffodils. Then this phytoene is synthesized the lycopene. It requires two genes or the two enzymes, that is phytoene desaturase and carotene desaturase, which has been isolated from Erwinia, and then this lycopene is converted into the beta carotene with the help of lycopene beta cyclase enzyme, and the gene responsible for this enzyme is taken from the daffodils. This beta carotene gives the yellowish color to the grains, and these grains, when taken by the human body, they converted into the vitamin A, and here beta carotene is considered as the precursor of vitamin A. So this is the synthesis of golden rice. Now the next one is flower sour tomato. It is the another example of genetically modified crop with increased value or nutrition. This flower sour tomato is the first genetically modified whole food to be sold commercially. This genetic modification was done using antisense technology by McGregor. That's why sometimes it has been known as the McGregor's tomato instead the flower sour tomato. By this, it blocks the expression of the enzyme polygalactouridinase, that is PG, in ripening tomato fruit. Actually, this polygalactouridinase or PG enzyme is the most common enzyme in fruits, which is responsible for softening of the fruit wall. Here, in case of the flower sour tomato, the expression of the TOM6 gene, which is responsible for the synthesis of the polygalacturanidase enzyme, is blocked using the already introduced cDNA transcript, that is the antisense RNA. This prevent softening and tomato remain fresh. It increases the shelf life of tomato. This has been produced by the company Calgen. It is the US-based agri biotech company, and it is approved by FDA and commercialized in 1994, and it is the first genetically modified fruit to be commercialized. Here I had given the brief account how it has been created. In normal case, the tomato synthesize the polygalacturanidase enzyme, and this is responsible for the softening of the fruit wall, and by this the softening of the fruit wall taken place. But in transgenic tomato, the action of this PG has been cancelled by the cDNA, and by this there is the blocking of the action of the PG, and the fruit ripening is delayed. Now the next application is the development of insect and pest resistant crops. So insect and pest attack is the most common and is one of the major reason behind huge loss of crops. This is the sole reason behind the development of genetically modified insect and pest resistant crop plants. The best known example is BT cotton, which is produced by Monsanto USA in 1987, and in 1996 it was ready to introduce in the US agriculture. Cotton is a major fiber crop in India, as we all know, and India ranked first in cotton cultivation. However, cotton was susceptible to the bollworm, and due to this bollworm attack, average loss of around 1,200 crore per year was there. So, the development of BT or biotechnologically intervened cotton is most essential. The second application of the biotechnology in agriculture that we are going to discuss is the development of insect and pest resistant crops. The insect and pest attack on the crop plant is one of the major reason behind huge yield loss of crops. This is the sole reason behind the development of genetically modified insect or pest resistant crop plants. The best known example is BT cotton, produced by Monsanto USA in 1987, and in 1996 it was ready to introduce in US agriculture. We all know that cotton is the major fiber crop in India, and India ranked first in cotton cultivation. However, cotton was susceptible to bollworm, and which is the reason of huge economic loss due to the less yield. To develop the BT cotton, the cry gene was taken from Bacillus thuringiensis. It was transferred to the cotton. This cry gene produced a crystalline protein. When this protein entered into the insect gut, due to its alkaline pH, this protein become toxic and start to perforate the cells of insect gut, and due to that the insect get died. Here I had tried to give the outline how this BT cotton has been prepared, and after the cultivation of this BT cotton in India around 2003 2000 four, India became number one in cotton production. Now the another example is the nematode resistant tobacco plant, the nematode Melidocaine incognita causes infection to the tobacco plant. The nematode resistant tobacco plant was obtained by RNA interface, that is RNAi technology. Here the gene from nematode itself that is responsible for its growth is used. This gene was introduced in tobacco plant. When it transcribes, it forms the double-stranded RNA. Here this double-stranded RNA is act as the defense mechanism of the plant. When the nematode infect the plant and transcribe its plants transcribe inside the plant cells, it produces mRNA. At the same time, the double-stranded RNA bind to the mRNA and block its activity, so that there is no synthesis of growth protein and thus the growth of nematode is prevented. Here I had given one paper which has all the details regarding this particular technology used to produce the nematode resistant tobacco plant. The next application is the production of the edible vaccines. Now this, in case of the production of the edible vaccines using the plants, the desired genes are isolated from different sources, and those genes are cloned in the vectors, and these vectors are integrated inside the plant cells, and those plant cells are used as the explants and then has been regenerated into the new plants, and thus new plants get the expression of that particular genes, desired genes, and become the edible vaccines. But we have to consider one important thing is that those developed vaccines or edible vaccines must have certain properties, ideal properties, then and then they could be utilized as the edible vaccines. These properties are these edible vaccines should be effective and affordable. The vaccination should be simple. These are not contaminated the environment. These must be long lasting. These must show the long lasting humoral and cellular immunities. These must be non toxic and non pathogenic. They must have very low level of side effects, and they must not cause the problem to the individuals with impaired immune systems. Using this particular aspect, till now we have developed the edible vaccines on hepatitis B, diarrhea, rabies, and gastrointestinal nausea, stomach cramps, and cholera using the plants like tobacco, potato, lettuce, and maize. The another most important aspect is production of the hirudin using the brassica plant. Hirudin is the anticoagulant basically, which has its application where blood must have to be remain as it is for some time. This gene of hirudin was taken from the leech. After isolation, this gene was introduced in Brassica nepis. This gene integrated in the genome of Brassica, and then it expresses. It expressed to form the hirudin, especially in seeds. Thus, hirudin is extracted along the seed oil. We can isolate the hirudin from oil and then use for our purpose. So this is an example how we can isolate a product from the plant. The another example is production of the antibiotics and growth hormones. Friends, plants are used to create the antibiotics for both humans and animal use. An expressing antibiotic protein in stock feed fed straight to the animals is less expensive than traditional antibiotic production. But this practice raises many bioethical issues. because the results are widespread, possibly needless use of antibiotics, which may encourage expansion of antibiotic-resistant bacterial strains. The most important crops which has been used or modified for the production of antibiotics and growth hormones are tobacco, potato, and banana. These are two papers which gives the details regarding the production of the substances which are used as antibiotics and growth hormones. Friends, the fifth application is production of biofuel using plants. As we all know that the agricultural sectors play a big role in the biofuel industry, as long as the feedstocks for the fermentation and cleansing of bio-oil, biodiesel and bioethanol is concerned. Genetic engineering and enzyme optimization techniques are being used to develop improved quality feedstocks for more efficient output of the resulting fuel products. High yielding, energy dense crops can minimize relative cost associated with the harvesting and transportation, that is per unit of energy derived, resulting in higher value of fuel production. Most important crops that have been used for biofuel production are the Panicum variegatum and Brassica rapa. Here I had given the sources from where I had taken this information. Enhanced characteristics of the genetically modified switch grass, that is Panicum variegatum, for high fuel production. Then plant genetic engineering for biofuel, then genetic modified plants reduce cost of biofuel production. So all these papers are giving the insight how biofuels has been produced using the plants and how it is cost effective. The next most important application is the biotic strain confrontation. Friends, see, our planet Earth have less than 20% of land as arable and suitable for cultivation. In general, each crop plant requires a set of optimum soil and environmental conditions for its proper growth and development. However, some crops have been heritably altered to make them more liberal, or conditions like salinity, cold and drought. The detection of genes in plants in charge of sodium uptake has led to growth of knockout plants able to grow in high salt environment. Up or down regulation of the records is usually the method used to alter the drought tolerance in plants. Some leading examples of drought tolerant plants are the maize and rapeseed. Here I had given one figure, that is the farmers from African countries like Uganda and Zambia. They have increased their yield of maize around threefold using the drought tolerant varieties. So this biotic strain confrontation is also an alternative to produce to get more product from the crop plants. Starting with the seventh application of development of GM flowers and other aesthetic plants. Friends, there are some simply aesthetic applications, and an example of this is the use of gene recognition and transfer technique to improve the color, smell, size and other features of the flower. Similarly, biotech has been used to make improvement to other common ornamental plants. Several varieties of rose, petunia, dianthus, chrysanthemum have been developed using this particular technique. You can see the colorful roses having different shades in one flower, then dianthus and different types of petunia on the slide. Here I have collected certain information regarding the genes and their resources and how they have been utilize to get the genetically modified ornamental plants like roses, petunia, dianthus, and other ornamental plants. So, and you can see how the roses has altered their colors in different sets. Okay. Here I have quoted some examples of genetically modified plants and animals like golden rice, flower sour tomato, BT cotton, aqua advantage salmon, and glow in dark animals. So of these golden rice, flower sour tomato, and BT cotton that we had already seen, this aqua advantage salmon is the salmon modified with the growth hormone regulating genes in order to grow market size in significantly less time. Then glow in dark animal is the animals modified with the genes of genes for fluorescent proteins will glow in the dark. This novel feature serves no practical use. Here I had presented few papers which indicates that new genetically modified corn produce up to 10% more than the similar type. That means here it has been given that this new genetically modified corn is having higher production than the traditional varieties. The another paper, it shows a world without hunger, organic or GM crops. So here there is the comparison of the crops is given which has been grown organically, and on the another side the GM crops are there, and at the end the battle was won by the GM crops. So this has been comparative account given in this particular paper. Here we could see that adaptability of worldwide farmers which is given to the genetically modified crops. Here is the data from 1996 to the 2016, how the genetically modified crops has been accepted for the cultivation. This bar graph shown that of the total soybean cultivated, 78% is genetically modified. Around 76% of the genetically modified cotton has been cultivated worldwide. Around 30% of the maize is cultivated, GM maize is cultivated worldwide. And as far as canola is concerned, the genetically modified varieties are around occupy around 29% of the area, land area. So one can say that the genetically modified crops are playing very vital role in the in meeting the agricultural needs of the human beings today. And they are also playing very vital role in food security, which is essential for the decent feeding of the growing population in coming days. So thank you everyone.